there was a broken plan. Think about it.
If you don't have any ends that night, that's a Sunday. And we're going to do it earlier, so that if you're older and don't like driving at night, we'll make sure that we're going to do it early enough so that you can be home before dark. Remember when Mom used to say, make sure you're home before dark? Well, now we do it just because it's better to be home before dark. And then we can take our shoes off and put our feet up and watch our favorite show or read a book or listen to music or just relax. June 9th, we're planning an all-church potluck luncheon. And that's going to be for right after worship. So plan on coming for that and plan on bringing a dish. There will be sign-up sheets for that as well, if they're not already. Any other announcements? Christine? No other announcements. So we have four birthdays. We have Sylvia Kaufman, Jared Brower, Linda Lagasse, and Tyler Ventura. So we'll sing happy birthday to Sylvia, Jared, Linda, and Tyler.
There is a love.
if you are able.
Prepare to take me before you, as to my enemies.
And it was trying to make us aware of all that we are doing to hurt our planet. And when I think about our planet, I think about God, because this is really God's planet that God created. And we are stewards of this planet. And I know that it's modern technology that has caused us to be participants in the ruining of our planet. But in early 1970, a group got together to start bringing awareness of some of the things that we can do as people on this planet to make it not so bad for the environment. And one of the things is plastics. And this year, the focus is actually on plastics. Because plastics are one of the things that are a serious problem, because a lot of it is not biodegradable. So we can start by doing more at home, by separating our recyclables so that they can be recycled, and those that are trash, to throw in the trash. But if we can select options that would not create more waste in the world, we can all do that right in our own homes. And if you are physically able and want to be out to do something physical in the community, you can go on Earth Day Rhode Island, and you will see there are a lot of different cleanup projects around the state that you can just volunteer some time to help with. You know, when we see the beauty and grandeur of God's world, maybe we can help keep it that way by being more aware of what even small things we can do that will help to make a difference for future generations. So let us enter into just a moment of prayer. Dear God, may we, your students, take pride in what you've created for us. May we recognize the beauty that you have created, and may we do our part to help keep it that way, so that your world will always remain beautiful, and that all of the living creatures on this planet will have a future as well. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our gospel lesson this morning is from the gospel according to John, chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because the hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. O Holy God, as always, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts are acceptable in your sight, O God, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I'm watching you. How many times have you heard that in your life? I know as a kid, I heard it a lot. I thought my mom and dad had eyes in the back of their head. And my mom would actually say to me, you know, I have eyes in the back of my head, and I used to look for them when I was really little. I thought maybe she did them behind her hair, but there really weren't eyes in there. But it's funny how parents know. Especially when you're doing something that you're not supposed to be doing. They always seem to know everything. And sometimes when we least expected it, they, or one of them, would just appear. I'm going to share a little story about that, how one day my dad just appeared. Now when I was a kid, both my parents smoked cigarettes. And it was very common. I mean, a lot of people smoked cigarettes then. And when I was little, I used to say, "You're killing me! You're killing me! Stop smoking! That smoke is terrible!" And then I used to hang around with this kid who wanted to take me to the bad side. And one day he said, "Have a cigarette, have a cigarette." I said, "No, no, no, I can't. I don't like a cigarette. I hate those things." But he said, "No, have a cigarette. It's really cool." So I said, "All right, I'll try it." Well, that got me started. And then I was like, oh boy, I never said anything about to my mother or father again about you're going to kill me. And I'm sure they started wondering, like, why doesn't he say anything about you've got to stop smoking? They probably knew, because they could probably smell on me that I was smoking. Not much, but, you know, we would go into the woods and, like, have cigarettes. You know, or we would sneak around the corner of the park where no one could see us and have cigarettes. And I was a paper boy. And one day I was on my paper route, and I was like 15, I think, and I was smoking a cigarette, and I saw my father coming around the corner. So I very quickly put the cigarette in my paper bag, thinking that he would just drive by and wait. Well, he did. He stopped the car, and he started up a conversation with me. I'll get nervous, like, these papers are going to catch fire. I'm like, I can get the cigarette out there quick. So my dad said, after a couple of minutes talking, he said, "I think you better get that cigarette out of your bag before it burns the papers." So I'm like, "Oh my God, oh my God." And I put it down and I put it up. And then I'm like, "Oh God, what's going to happen now?" So he said, "I don't want you smoking. Next time I catch you smoking, you're going to be grounded for a week." I said, "Okay, Dad, okay, Dad." Well, of course, I kept smoking. And then the second time my dad called me, he said, "I don't want you smoking. Next time I catch you smoking, you're going to get beaten." And I'm like, "Okay, Dad." So then one day, my mother and father sat me down at the kitchen table and said, "We need to have a little chat." I'm like, "What do I do now?" And they said, "Yeah, we need to have a chat about smoking." confused. But I said, well, maybe I'll ask. Maybe he's not supposed to ask. So I asked, and he said to my mother, as they're both sitting there smoking cigarettes, I guess it's okay, just don't smoke too much. And at that time, even though on the card, the paper, it said that smoking could be hazardous to your health, it was very common. Every movie you watched, every television show, they're smoking, and it was cool, and it was sexy. I mean, remember those cigarettes with the long cigarettes with the cigarette holders that they used to call? In all the old movies, it was romantic, it was cool. Well, anyway, so I started smoking, but that's just about, I have an eyes in the back of your head. And sometimes it seemed like a curse that they were always seemingly watching over me. But then I realized, as I got a little older, that the reason why they were watching over was me because they loved me and they cared for me. And then Sunday school, I remember there were certain teachers that always watched over me. And they would be scolding me, stop running down the hall! But I liked to run down the hall. And now, like when we have kids here, like if there's nobody in the church, the thing they want to do is they want to run down this aisle. And when they run, they want to leap up onto the altar. And I don't stop them. But when they get to the altar, I say, stay there for a moment. And I will explain to them that this is the sanctuary of the Lord. And if you're going to run here because you love Jesus, and if you're going to leap up onto this altar because you want to be close to Jesus, then that's okay. But if you're just going to run because you want to play, this is not the place to play. And they're usually cool with that, and they understand. And then there was school. But you know how teachers are always watching over you? Well, I don't know about you, but I remember all of my elementary school teachers. And then in 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grades, there were certain teachers that I remember. And I think it's the ones that I enjoyed their courses. And the same in college. But when I think about elementary school in 3rd grade, there was Miss Carrigan. Now, Miss Carrigan was an older woman who wore what we would call antique dresses. You remember those kind of dresses, right? They had the belt across the middle, they were usually flowery, they were long sleeves, and they wore orthopedic Oxford shoes. Do you remember those shoes? Yeah. Well, that's Miss Carrigan. And I was one of those kids that liked to talk to my friends. And she would get tired of it, and she'd say, Wayne Packle, up here by my desk. And there was a little desk right there by her desk. And I was like, oh God, now I have to sit and look at her, like right there. I quickly learned to not talk during class. But you know then, as I grew older, I thought, I get why she was watching after me, because if I was talking the whole time, I wouldn't learn the lessons. And her job was to help me to learn. You know, our faith is like that too. Our gospel lesson reminds us that Jesus is the good shepherd. The shepherd that watches over his sheep, as we, folks, are the sheep. And there are sheep out there that don't even know that they're going to be the sheep of Jesus' flock. But many times, they feel something. They feel a connection somehow. Sometimes it's through someone or something that happens, or they go to a church and they experience a spiritual moment at a wedding or a baptism of a family member or sometimes even a funeral. And they feel something beautiful and something special. And that opens their eyes and their hearts to wanting to experience more. In this scripture lesson, John shares that the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. And that's kind of what the powers of evil do to us in our lives. You can think about it as the devil, you can think about it as whatever you want, but I know that there are powers of good and evil in the world. And the powers of evil always want to take us out from the good. And they want us to see the bad and to be bad people. Jesus watches over us all. Jesus knows when we are in the state of knowing and recognizing Him. And in order to know Him, we need to hear the words that God sent through Him. We need to listen to the stories of faith and parables and lessons that Jesus wants us to hear. We need to listen. We need to listen so that we can understand. But the only way we can is if we are paying attention and not getting distracted. As most of you know, I went to South Carolina this week as I was officiating at my cousin's son's wedding. And it's been a long time since I was away from there, so I decided to go a couple of days early. And one of the things that I needed, I thought, was a new pair of black shoes, because my shoes are really uncomfortable. And as we grow older, our feet change. And my left foot is like one of those things that's changed, and it's always bugging me. So I have to buy shoes that are accordingly comfortable. And that's why I wear Skechers a lot of the times. I try to get dressed in ones, but my feet are in heaven. They're memory foam, soft-sided, and puts a little bounce in my step as if I don't have enough bounce in my step. But Skechers can help. So while I was in South Carolina, and I decided that I was going to go and buy shoes, I asked the person at the desk at the hotel where I should go. And they said, town center. And I said, okay, how do I get there? Because I didn't rent a car. Well, Uber. I said, is there a bus that goes there? Oh, no. Okay, so I'll call an Uber. So I get an Uber, and all week long I kept getting Ubers. And I had some really amazing conversations with people that were Uber drivers. I get to the town center mall. Needless to say, I didn't find any shoes. But I had some amazing conversations. The next day, I decided to go into Charleston, because I was staying outskirts, to save a little money. And I went to the Tanger Outlets. So we have Tanger Outlets all over the place, right? There's in Maine, there's in Hampshire, some in Massachusetts, and I think we maybe have one in Miami, maybe down in Connecticut. And the Tanger Outlets are like all the highest end clothing and shoe stores. So I said, I must be able to find something there. And I went in every shoe store, and I couldn't find that perfect pair. I found out here that my left foot, which is the problem foot, felt amazing. But the right foot, the shoe would not feel right. So I said, okay, I guess I'm not going to choose it. So I leave that store, and I start walking, and there's this little Airstream food vending place right in the middle of this outside mall. And I stopped because I was intrigued, because it was biscuits, homemade biscuits. And I don't know about you, but I love homemade biscuits. And outside their Airstream trailer, on an easel it says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, Luke 4, chapter 4. And then I added, but by every word that comes forth from the mouth of God. But I thought, isn't that interesting that this food place has, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. So I think that their motto was because they serve biscuits. But their biscuits have really good stuff in them. There was some that had shrimp and crab meat in them. There was some that had sweet potatoes and cheddar cheese. The sweet potatoes and cheddar cheese, the name of it was the Great I Yam. Y-A-M. I loved it. The cinnamon one was called Cinna Heaven. C-I-N-N, like cinnamon. Cinna Heaven. Berry Divine. The apples of his eye. Preaches Peach. Treasures from the sea. A slice of heaven. Holy Jalapeno. And the Garden of Eden. And I thought, I wonder why they chose these names. So I went and I read the menu, and they all sounded amazing. And I'm like, I want one of all of them. But I couldn't, because they were good-sized biscuits. So I bought the Great I Am. And I was sitting at a table right there, and this woman came over and said, "How are the biscuits?" I said, "Oh my God, they're amazing." I said, "You should get some." She said, "I make them." I said, "Well, you do a good job." She said, "My husband is inside, and I'm just coming to see if he needs me to make more." So I'm like, "Okay, cool." So she goes over to him, and I said, "Before you go, can I ask you why you chose these names that seem to be divinely inspired?" And she said, "My husband is a pastor." I said, "No way, I'm a pastor." So of course, I go over and I introduce myself to the pastor who's behind selling these heavenly biscuits. We started a conversation, and it was a beautiful blessing. I had the two great IMs I love. I'm going to have us do a heavenly biscuit luncheon someday because they were amazing. So then, I'm done. I'm going to head back to my hotel. I call another Uber. I get in the car, and there's this elderly black gentleman who's listening to what we listen to up here is K-Lo. It's contemporary Christian music. And I love it. And I'm listening to the words, and I'm like, "Oh, I hear you listening to Christian music. That's awesome. I love it." He said, "Well, I'm a pastor." And I said, "I'm a pastor." So we had this wonderful conversation. We exchanged information. I'm actually going to go on his Facebook page. He's going to go on our Facebook page. And we're going to have conversations. But when these things were happening, I was like, this is God right here in the shopping mall. This is God right here in the Uber. There are subtle signs of God everywhere if we just open our minds. And when we do that, we will remember that the Good Shepherd is always watching over us. And when we need to feel his love, or when we need to be reminded that he is near, we will get a sign. So keep your eyes, ears, and hearts open for the unexpected touches of the Holy Spirit. Now we're going to sing this beautiful hymn, which is an insert in your bulletins called Knowing You. Many of you may not know this hymn. I have sung a version of it on some of my early recordings with Jane, but it was on my mind a lot last week, so I said I needed to record it today. So hope you like it as much as I do. That's all Jesus wants. Jesus wants us to love. To love Him. To love the Holy Trinity of God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And to love each other. Now, dear friends, comes our time when we gather together in prayer. And if anyone can make it after I got prayer requests, does anybody have a prayer request that they'd like to share? Let us be in the spirit of prayer and feel God's Holy Spirit as we share our needs and our joys. Holy God, as I am always reminded of the world, that you are there at every turn. If we only open our hearts and spirits and minds, be with us now as we offer up names for people who need to feel your love, who need to feel your healing energy, who need to know your compassion and mercy. We believe that when we pray as a family, our voice may be just a little bit loud. So from our mouths to your ears, we pray for peace in our hearts and in the world. We pray for the family and friends and all those who were inspired by the man Deason, the beautiful gospel singer who passed away this week. We pray for this crazy world that they find a better way to live with one another. We pray for our dear Linda and her family. We pray for patience for teachers as they go back to school. And we pray for respect from the students and the parents to those who are sharing their lives so that the younger people may learn. May they, like I do, realize that they're only trying to help, to better their lives, to help them to learn. We pray for Judy's ankle and for her sister Barbara, for David's mother, Bertha, and for the family as they go through trying and difficult times. We pray for Linda, Lois's niece, who had a back operation. We pray for Maureen's car that it comes back all fixed. We continue to pray for Dennis's, Maureen. We pray for Dorothy and praise God that she was able to not fall this morning and was able to get here for worship. We pray for health. For all. We pray for David and Red. We pray for you to give us the ability to feel calmness in our spirit so that we may glorify you. We pray for Sandy. We pray for safe travel. As she heads to Tampa, Florida. And for all those whom we have not met, reaching dear Lord, I also want to pray for my dear friend Debbie Castellucci, who passed away earlier this week, and for her family and friends and all those whose lives she touched. May she find eternal peace in your glory. And may her spirit, like angels, fly all over to all of her favorite places and touch all of her favorite people so that they know that her salvation has come to fruition in me. And also for my sister-in-law, Jolynn, as she continues her struggles, and my partner, Glenn, reach out just to share our love and to let people know that we're thinking about them and to remind them that they are never alone, that God is always right there by their side. And so on we go.
Thank you.
glorify you in all that we do here in this church, in our community, and in your world. We offer with love in our hearts and gratitude for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 229, That Easter Day with Joy Was Bright, and we will just sing verse 1.